Hi, this is Matt Baker. I recently completed a series on this channel called Who Wrote the Bible, in which I explored the topic from a strictly historical point of view. This led to comments from many people asking me to do something similar for the Quran. So that's what I'm going to attempt to do in this video. However, keep in mind that the Bible and the Quran are two very different books, both from an academic perspective as well as from a theological perspective. So that's going to make things, how can I say this, a bit tricky. First of all, you have to understand that the Quran is not simply the Muslim equivalent of the Bible. If you want to make a more accurate comparison, it would be better to say that the Quran is the Muslim equivalent of Jesus. Here's what I mean by that. Both groups believe that God revealed himself to humans in many different ways during ancient times. However, Christians believe that God chose to reveal himself in a final, universal way through Jesus. Not through the New Testament, but through the person of Jesus. So, for Christians, the Bible is not the ultimate revelation. It is simply the story of the ultimate revelation. While Muslims also believe that God chose to reveal himself in a final, universal way, but not through Jesus. For them, Jesus was just another human prophet, as was Muhammad. Muslims believe that the final universal revelation was not a person, but rather a written text, the Quran. So for Christians, the Bible is important, but it is not as important as Jesus. For Muslims, it's the reverse. Muhammad is important, but he is not as important as the Quran. What about Jews then? Isn't the Torah the Jewish version of God's final universal revelation? Well, no, because for us Jews, there is no such thing as a universal revelation. According to Judaism, the Torah was meant for the Jewish people only, not for all of humankind. So Jews don't actually have anything that's the equivalent of either Jesus or the Quran. Now, there's another major difference between the Bible and the Quran that must be made clear. This chart represents various ways in which a religious text can be viewed, ranging from 100% divine authorship to 100% human authorship. For Muslims, the Quran is all the way over here. They believe that their holy book was literally dictated to the Prophet Muhammad, word for word, by God, via the angel Gabriel. Very few Christians or Jews view their scriptures in this way. Although a very small minority believe something along those lines, the vast majority would simply say that their holy books were inspired by God, meaning that both God and human authors played a role. Now, when it comes to how big of a role that God played versus how big of a role that the human authors played, there are several different positions. Some lean towards inerrancy, meaning that although humans wrote the books in their own unique styles, God made sure that they contained absolutely no errors, whether scientific or historical. Others lean more towards infallibility, meaning that while the Bible's overall message is trustworthy on matters of faith and religious practice, the authors were obviously limited by the scientific and historical understandings of their time. Now, even though I am a Jew and also a theist, I would actually place all works of religious literature all the way over here. But I would like to make it clear that my position is a minority one. Most Jews and Christians would fit into the inerrancy or infallibility categories, with the more conservative types leaning towards inerrancy and the more liberal types leaning towards infallibility. However, the main point I want to make through all of this is that the Muslim view of the Quran is very different than the average Christian or Jew's view of the Bible. Therefore, if you're a Muslim, the answer to the question, who wrote the Quran, is pretty straightforward. Allah, aka God, wrote the Quran. Sure, Allah may have revealed it through the angel Gabriel to the Prophet Muhammad, but neither Gabriel nor Muhammad is its ultimate author. God is the ultimate author of the Quran, and God alone. This is something that, for Muslims, must be taken on faith. So if that's what you believe, and if you're likely to be offended by hearing any alternative theories, you should stop watching this video now. However, if you're wondering how secular academics might answer the question, or how people from other religions might answer the question, feel free to keep watching. Okay, so the next thing you need to know is that unfortunately, very little research has been done on the Quran from a textual criticism perspective. When it comes to the Bible, we've got lots of research going back hundreds of years. But when it comes to the Quran, not so much. Therefore, keep in mind that everything I'm going to discuss from this point forward is far more tentative and hypothetical than what I discussed in the Bible episodes. But before we get into the possible sources for the Quran and who compiled them, I want to tell you a little bit about how the Quran is arranged. Unlike the Bible, which is divided into many different books, the Quran is really just one book. It does have divisions called surahs, but surahs are more like chapters, not separate books. There are 114 of them in total, and they are arranged not thematically or chronologically, but simply by length. Aside from the very first surah, which is kind of a preface, the longest chapter is placed at the very beginning, and then it pretty much goes by size, with the shortest chapters coming at the end. The only other major way to divide the Quran is by dividing it into the Meccan surahs and the Medinan surahs. According to tradition, Muhammad and his followers initially lived in Mecca, but then in the year 622 CE, they moved to Medina. So some surahs were revealed to him in the first location, whereas others were revealed in the second location. Most Islamic scholars tend to agree on which ones are which, and in fact, there is even a generally agreed upon list in which every surah is ordered from first to last. So, for example, chapter 96, called Al-Alaq, is considered to have been the first revelation. Traditionally, this event is dated to the year 609 CE. On the other hand, chapter 110, called An-Nasr, is considered to have been the last revelation, being given to Muhammad in the year 632, just a few months before he died. Now, according to tradition, Muhammad was illiterate, and therefore he shared his revelations orally only. His various companions either memorized them or wrote parts of them down. Therefore, by the time Muhammad died, there was not yet a complete written version of the Quran. Most Muslims believe that this occurred during the reign of the Caliph Uthman, approximately 20 years after the death of Muhammad. According to Sunni tradition, it was Uthman who created the first standardized version of the Quran, ordering all variant copies to be destroyed. Now, among secular historians, there is some disagreement on how best to understand these early years of Islam. Some secular historians basically accept the traditional narrative, except for the part about the revelations being from God. According to this view, Muhammad was the primary author of the Quran, regardless of whether he shared the content orally or in a written format. On the other hand, other secular historians question whether or not anything from the first 150 years of Islamic history can be trusted. They argue that everything we know about this period comes entirely from sources written much later, during the Islamic Golden Age, and therefore they see the stories about Islam's initial conquests as being more legendary in nature. According to this scenario, the Quran was probably a document that evolved more slowly, with several people having a hand in its production. Personally, I lean more towards accepting the traditional narrative. Again, except for the divine revelation part. This is because we do have several non-Islamic references to the Prophet Muhammad that date to just a few years after his death. We also have a partial manuscript of the Quran, known as the Sana'a manuscript, that dates to around the year 670. This indicates that the Quran can be traced back very close to Muhammad's lifetime. However, something else that the Sana'a manuscript seems to indicate, though, is that there were probably several slightly different versions of the Quran in existence during the early years of Islam. If you want to learn more about the Sana'a manuscript, Al-Mukaddama just released a video about it today, so be sure to check it out. I'll leave a link at the end of this video. The final thing I want to address is the sources that were used by Muhammad in the creation of the Quran. Obviously, for a Muslim, there is no such thing as the sources for the Quran. There is only one source, and that source is Allah. But for a secular historian, Muhammad must have gotten his material from somewhere. So, from where did he get it? The important thing to remember here is that Muhammad lived in a world in which Judaism and Christianity looked quite a bit different than they do today. A lot of people assume that when Muhammad showed up, there were people called Jews, there were people called Christians, and then because of him, there were now people called Muslims. Three nice, neatly divided groups. But this was not the case. For example, the Talmud, which would go on to become the authoritative text for rabbinical Judaism, was only recently completed. It was finished around the year 500 CE, just 70 years before the birth of Muhammad. So there was likely still quite a bit of diversity among Jews, especially in faraway places such as southern Arabia and Ethiopia. And the same was true of Christianity. As I mentioned in my video on the Gospels, there were initially many different Christianities, and it took many centuries before the dominant version stamped out all the other versions, which it considered to be heresies. Remember, although it started in the 1st century CE, Christianity didn't really take off until the 4th century CE, when it became the dominant religion of the Roman Empire. It would thus have been around the 4th and 5th centuries, not too long before Muhammad, that the so-called heretical versions of Christianity might have shifted to places outside of Roman influence. Places like, you know, Arabia. In other words, it's not hard to imagine that Muhammad would have come into contact with various different types of Christians and Jews, and that the types of Christians and Jews that he came into contact with were the ones that were outside of the mainstream. For example, there once existed a group called the Ebionites that fit somewhere in between Judaism and Christianity. On the one hand, they accepted Jesus as an important prophet and saw him as being the Messiah. But on the other hand, they rejected his divinity and continued to follow Jewish laws, such as not eating pork. Sounds a lot like Islam to me. As far as we know, the Ebionites had mostly disappeared by the time that Muhammad came onto the scene. However, there were likely still groups around that had been influenced by them, groups that then perhaps went on to influence Muhammad. So now that you understand the general situation, let's get down to some specifics. If you're familiar with the Bible and then start to read the Quran, you'll definitely notice some similarities. Many of the same characters show up, and even some of the same stories are told. However, some of the stories are quite different. For example, sometimes there is information missing, and other times there is information added. If you watch our video about the Islamic prophet's family tree, which I'll link to in the description, you can find out more about what these similarities and differences are. One thing that is clear is that Muhammad did not copy directly from the Bible. In other words, there are no sections of the Quran where the text matches perfectly with text from the Bible. It's more like he heard someone summarize a biblical story, and then he in turn summarized it using his own words. But what about all the extra information, the various details that are not found anywhere in the Bible? Well, let's look at several examples. The first is a story about Abraham. In the Quran, in Surah 21, Abraham smashes his father's idols during his youth in Babylon, and then is thrown into a fire by the king as a punishment. But God saves him, and he survives unharmed. Now, although this story is not found in the Bible, it is in fact found in a text that predates the Quran. It comes from a commentary on the book of Genesis written by a rabbi sometime between 300 and 500 CE. So it's certainly possible that Muhammad was familiar with the story. Another example is a story about Mary, the mother of Jesus. In the Quran, in Surah 19, Mary comes across a palm tree while she is pregnant. In order to feed his mother, Jesus performs a miracle from within the womb, causing figs to fall from the tree when shaken. Again, this story is not found in any of the four canonical Gospels. However, as I mentioned in my episode about the Gospels, there were actually many other Gospels, ones that did not make it into the New Testament. One of these is known as Pseudo-Matthew. In Pseudo-Matthew, a very similar story is told about Mary and the palm tree. The only difference is that in Pseudo-Matthew, the palm tree actually bends its branches so that Mary can reach the figs. Now, Pseudo-Matthew was written around the same time as Muhammad lived, but in a very different location. So I think it's unlikely that Muhammad got the story directly from Pseudo-Matthew, or that Pseudo-Matthew got it directly from Muhammad. What's more likely is that this was simply a well-known story that was floating around at the time, and that both authors were familiar with it. My third example is the story of the sleepers in the cave. In the Quran, in Surah 18, it tells a story about some men who were being persecuted for their beliefs. They take refuge in a cave, where God causes them to go into a deep sleep, one that miraculously lasts over 300 years. They therefore end up escaping the persecution. This story is actually a well-known Christian legend that appears in multiple sources predating the Quran, the earliest one being that of the Syrian poet Jacob of Sirah. One more example. Later in the same surah, Surah 18, the Quran mentions a man called Dhul-Qarnayn, a phrase that literally means the two-horned one. According to the Quran, Dhul-Qarnayn travels to the east, to a mountainous region where a group of people are being persecuted by two evil nations, known as Gog and Magog. He helps them by building a giant wall to keep Gog and Magog at bay. This story is very similar to a well-known legend about Alexander the Great that was very common in ancient times. In fact, Alexander the Great was often depicted as having horns, hence the name Dhul-Qarnayn, the two-horned one. What all of these examples show is that the Quran includes many stories that can be found in other texts that existed at the time when it was created. So not only did the Quran use the Bible as a source, it also used Jewish commentaries, Christian apocryphal literature, and even sources that contained stories about pagan heroes. In other words, the Quran was very much a product of its time. Let me put it this way. If a person were to go back in a time machine to the Middle East in the year 600 CE and randomly collect a bunch of stories that were popular at the time, that collection would likely look very similar to the contents of the Quran. Of course, the Quran also includes commentary on those stories and theological lessons, so even if one doesn't see the Quran as being a word-for-word miracle sent from God, one can still see it as containing valuable insight. Now, of course, one could argue that the reason why the Quran contains many stories that can be found in other literature of the time is that the Quran is, in fact, an accurate account of events authored by the creator of the universe. Taken on faith, this is indeed a valid position. However, taken strictly on the principles of the historical method, it is not. There is a clear textual history that demonstrates how the various biblical stories developed over time. However, according to Muslims, the Bible is simply a corrupt version of several now lost texts, such as the Torah, the Zabur, and the Injil. If this were true, one would expect to find some sort of textual evidence for these older works. But as of yet, no such evidence has ever been found. Finally, I want to mention a hypothesis about the Quran that is very much just a hypothesis, meaning that it is definitely not the mainstream position, even among secular scholars. It is the one found in the 2000 book, The Syro-Aramaic Reading of the Quran, by Christoph Luxemburg. In this book, Luxemburg uses linguistic arguments to claim that the Quran was heavily influenced by the Syriac language, a language that was spoken in Syria and much of the Middle East during the time of Muhammad. In particular, Syriac was used by early Christians, and therefore Luxembourg argues that certain sections of the Quran might be directly based on Syriac liturgies. Now, it might seem odd to claim that the most famous book written in Arabic is actually heavily based on a totally different language, in this case, Syriac. However, keep in mind that the Arabic of the Quran is in fact quite mysterious in parts. Because Arabic doesn't have vowels, there is always some room for debate on how to translate certain words. But again, let me remind you that this last hypothesis has yet to gain very much traction. Okay, so that was a look at the question, who wrote the Quran? And I'm happy to announce that I've decided to extend this series for at least one more episode. I've had several requests for a video on who wrote the Book of Mormon, so I've decided to tackle that subject sometime soon as well. For now, I encourage you to check out Al-Mukaddimah's video on the Sana'a manuscript. You can click the link on screen now or find it in the description. Thanks for watching.